Okay, we're recording. Thank you for helping me here. Welcome back to week 11. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Week 11, and today is Friday, I think, right?
Thursday.
Just kidding. Today's Thursday. I just feel like it's Friday somehow. All right, Cadet McGee, let's rock and roll.
Flight, Hudson Hutt. Element 1, report.
All present and accounted for, sir.
Element 2, report.
All present and accounted for, sir.
Pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Element 1, fall in for uniform inspection.
Outstanding, sir.
Professional wear?
Yes, sir.
All right, everything looks good. You learned 100% today.
Thank you, sir.
How are you doing today, Cadet?
Outstanding, sir.
T-shirt? Everything looks good. Earned 100% for today.
Thank you, sir.
How are you doing today, Cadet?
Outstanding, sir.
Everything looks good. You earned 100% for today.
Thank you, sir.
How are you doing today, Cadet?
Outstanding, sir.
Have your BDUs? Look pretty good. ID. Hair looks good. You've earned 100% for today.
Thank you, sir.
How are you doing today, Cadet?
Outstanding, sir.
On your t-shirt, everything looks good. Wait. You don't have your ID?
No, sir. I don't have my ID, sir.
You lose
1.5.
1.5. You've earned 90% for today.
Thank you, sir.
I didn't take it,
huh? Outstanding, sir.
Where's your uniform?
Forgot your uniform today, sir.
Alright, tomorrow you can make up for 75% of the credit, but you've earned 0 for today.
Thank you, sir.
Element 1, fall out. How are you doing today, Cadet?
Outstanding, sir.
Professional wear? You have your ID? You've earned 100% for today.
Thank you, sir.
How are you doing today, Cadet?
Outstanding, sir.
He gets a 0 because he's chewing gum.
Thank you, sir.
And you don't have a belt, so.
He gets a 0.
-5.
You've earned 0%.
Thank you, sir.
Do we have the opportunity to make it up tomorrow?
No, he gets a 0.
Thank you, sir.
How are you doing today, Cadet?
Outstanding, sir.
T-shirt. Everything looks good. You have your ID. You've earned 100% for today.
Thank you, sir.
How are you doing today, Cadet?
Outstanding, sir.
Where's your uniform? Well, you've earned 0% for today. You'll have the opportunity to make up for 75% of credit tomorrow.
Thank you, sir.
Element 2, fall out. And element leaders, fall in to inspect your flight command and flight sergeant.
How you doing, Sergeant?
Outstanding, sir.
Where's your ID, Cadet?
At home, sir.
Everything else looks good. Burned the 90 for the day.
Thank you, sir.
How are you doing today, Cadet?
Outstanding, sir.
You've earned 100 for the day, Cadet. Thank you, sir.
Okay, guys, appreciate that. Anyone here wants to see if you can swoon and ask politely and maybe potentially in a remote possibility, go to Meteor Crater tomorrow. They quietly get up and go leave. We will have that coming on. Okay, so here we go, guys. What I'm going to go through now is something everybody needs to hear, and I'm not sure if you ever get taught this, okay? So this year, as every year, I talk to every one of you guys about your career path, what you're going to do after high school, and whether or not you're accomplishing it in high school. I have found that not many, maybe a quarter of you, don't have your act together. And so, I'm going to give you a high school highway of what you should be doing. And this goes from freshmen, sophomore, to seniors. This is sort of what you need to be doing. And I guess we never specifically teach this, but this is the way it is. It may vary a little bit, depending on which college you go, or which professional program you want to take, or what you want to do after high school, but I'm going to talk to you about what I've seen in teaching 7 years, 900 cadets, and this is what needs to be done. I just told this to my freshman PE class, and it woke them up. Okay, the goal of high school is to find out what you like or what you don't like. Do you like English? Do you like math? Do you like basketball? You like volleyball? Do you like science club? You like English club? You need to find out in high school what you like and don't like. As a ninth grader, when I talk to you guys privately about your career path and your grades and what you're doing, I expect you to be at least starting to think about whether you want big pictures. Whether you want to go to college or no college. That's ninth grade. Do you have to have an answer? No. But you have to be thinking about it. Did your parents go to college? Did they go to a particular college? They're forcing you to go there? Your dad's a plumber, but he has a great job. He's making $100,000 as a plumber. Yeah, that's looking pretty good. I might want to do that. I don't care. Beauticians, tattoo artists, cooks, locksmiths, plumbers, electricians, doctors. We have an OBGYN student, Air Force Academy, West Point, Tulane, University of Pennsylvania, all Arizona schools, Colorado, Texas A&M, Norwich, all those schools, Auburn, the ones I have on the board, the pennants. I've sent kids to all these schools. And so somewhere in your ninth grade, you need to be thinking college or no college. And by 10th grade, you kind of need to have a plan. Have a plan. What do you do in ninth grade? You make your best grades. Okay? You cannot screw around like you did in middle school. If you make, what happens in sixth grade if you fail English? What does that mean? What do you do the next semester?
Retake it.
No, and you don't retake anything in middle school. You go to the next semester of English. If you fail history on one quarter or one semester in seventh grade, guess what? You go to the next semester of history again. In high school, your goal is to have no F's, but really, you want your best grades. As a ninth grader, if you start to make F's, then you're going to be retaking them. You're going to be behind. And honestly, if you're making F's as a ninth grader, then guess what? In general, this is not positive, but in general, that's telling me you don't want to go to college. Because first of all, you're going to be behind, and you're going to have to catch up. But if you're making F's, something's not going on. You're over your head, you're not concentrating, you're not turning in. Whenever I see F's, the next thing I do is I click on there, and I see whether or not you're actually turning in every assignment. If you're not turning in every assignment, then that means you're lazy, lazy, lazy. And guess what? Those people don't go to college. And oh, by the way, those people don't have plumbing jobs making $100,000 if you're lazy. You haven't grown up. You're immature. So I see a lot of immature freshmen who don't get it. Okay, you come to be a sophomore. I expect you to have a plan. By then, you also might have a get well plan. What's a get well plan, Pat McGee? What's a get well plan? Yes, sir.
It's making up for freshman year.
Making up for screw ups, right? So you have a screw up here because you're loving playing basketball, or you're loving your new girlfriend you met in high school because you'd never seen her because she went to the other middle school, and you're just loving life. Or maybe your family got divorced, maybe your dad died, maybe you had to move, they lost a job, I don't know. There's lots of reasons to make F's. But the bottom line is you need to start having a get well plan here, because guess what? If you don't get well as a sophomore, junior, what's going to happen when you're a senior? What? You're not going to graduate, right? You're telling me I am not going to graduate from high school. And I guess then you're going to answer the question about whether you're going to college or not college. You're going to make your living flipping burgers if you're lucky enough to get that job. All right, so as a 10th grader, the college-bound kid needs to be on top of everything, good grades, but I suggest that you take the PSAT the first time, and that's in October of your sophomore year. October your sophomore year, you need to take the PSAT. It is a practice. It doesn't count for anything. It puts you under pressure. It sits you over there for 3 hours. You're in one little chair. It stinks. But guess what? So does a lot of life stinks when you have these tests that can change your life. You got to practice. And then also, here, as a sophomore, besides making good grades, besides taking the PSAT, you need to start studying for the ACT or the SAT, depending on which one you do best on. So, by the time your 11th grade year, you're a junior, you take the PSAT for real, and you take the ACT, SAT after Christmas. And the ACT, SAT, after Christmas, your junior year, tells you, take both of them. I suggest take both of them and see which way your brain works. Which one do you do the best on? In general, West Coast kids do better on ACT. East Coast kids do better on SAT. I took the SAT in South Carolina. Yes, sir.
Sir, what's the difference between the SAT and the ACT?
There is a difference. In the test, in the results, there's not really a difference for 98% of the colleges, okay? So it's whatever way your brain works is the best. One of the tests will say, don't fill in every answer because we penalize you. One test says, fill in every answer because we don't penalize you. Okay, there are different parts in taking the test. Welcome back, guys. Come on in. Did you see Colonel DeKemper?
He said to go see him after this class period.
So he did say maybe, maybe.
He said yes.
Okay, great. Well, then good. You guys are going to Media Crater. Okay, I am going to repeat, because good instructors repeat stuff that is very important. I'm going through different career counseling, because this week I'm seeing about everybody here in my program, 170 plus cadets, talking about all your grades, and you guys are kind of mixed up. Some of you, 25% of you, are mixed up on what you need to do in your life and the high school highway. Maybe I should put this online. I am putting it online. In high school, you need to figure out what you like and don't like. That's just as easy as that. Do you like English? Do you not like physics? Do you like sports? Be a physics teacher, PE teacher, or do you want to be an engineer? Ninth grade, I expect you to start thinking about whether or not you, God bless you, thinking about whether you like want to go to college or no college. If your dad is a construction developer, God bless you, and you're working, helping him build houses, and he wants you to inherit the business. If your dad's a rancher and has a big ranch, then guess what? Or owns the local automobile dealership, guess what? You know what you want to do. But you got to think about this stuff in ninth grade. You don't have an answer, but you got to think about it. As a ninth grader, you don't want to make any F's, because if you make F's, you're going to be taking them over, and you want to get your best grades. As a 10th grader, you need to have a plan. You're thinking about it as a ninth grader, 10th grader, you need to have a plan. Am I going to college or am I not going to college? If I'm going to shoot for college, there are different courses you need to take. You need to take 3 lab sciences. You need to take 2 years, preferably 4 years of a language. You need to show that you're better than the rest to go to college. So as a 10th grader, if you made F's your 9th grade, you need to have a get well plan, which means how am I going to make up what I screwed up. Okay. And also as a 10th grader, I want you to take the PSAT, the pre-SAT, the first time you can, which is a sophomore, and it's a practice. Okay, so I met half dozen sophomores that had already taken it as a practice. The SAT is a tough class. The ACT is a tough test. You got to practice. 11th grader, you're going to take the pre-SAT for real. That the pre-ACT is called the plan. You can take that too. Those are for real. And believe it or not, they're a pretty good indicator on how you're going to do academically. Believe it or not, you can sit there and argue about tests or whatever, but in America, they will tell you what you're doing. And oh, by the way, in Arizona, which I'm talking to all the Arizona kids, in general, nationally, Arizona kids have very good GPAs. They work real hard in their schools, but they have below national standards in ACT national tests, which tells me you're learning what's in your school, but you're not preparing for the national test. So you need to prepare for the national test, take your ACT, SAT after Christmas. I suggest you take both, see which way your brain works, and keep taking it. So that if you're applying to college, the ACT and SAT test is cumulative. So if you take it twice, and you do better on some things than the other, it's a cumulative grade, and you get your best grade. Okay? If you're applying to the top tier schools in America, if you have made straight A's for freshman, sophomore, and you're working in junior year, if you're going to apply to Harvard, Princeton, Yale, Stanford, the academies, Ivy League schools, that's the top tier of America, then you need to take these tests 5 times or 4 times. And what you're going to do is you're going to take it after Christmas, say January, February, find out what you do best on. You do better on the ACT. Well, then guess what? Take it in April and also May. So you've taken it once, twice, your junior year, and then your senior year, you're going to take it in October and September, and that's 3 and 4 times. You're going to have your best results. The reason I say this is I am the Air Force Academy liaison officer who's done pretty well. I was the winner of the national award last year. I've seen kids do this and do well. Every year, this ROTC sends cadets to Embry-Riddle. And your scores mean huge results. And they're a huge amount of money related to your GPA and your ACTs. If you have a GPA of 3.8, you're going to get more money than somebody with a 3.5. And so when I hit students and say, oh, well, sir, I got to get a job and I'm trying to save up money for college. And I go, how many hours you work? Oh, I'm working 25 hours. Got to save up money for college. And I look, click, 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 straight C's and a D. Why'd you make the D? Oh, well, I was working, saving money for college. You've got to be kidding me. If you make better grades, you're going to make thousands of dollars more than working as a teenager and saving $2,000 for, 2 months. Same thing with the sports. How many of your friends here at Prescott High School have you met? I'm going to get a volleyball scholarship. I'm going to be a track and field. I'm going to get a basketball scholarship. Full ride. I'm going to get a full ride football scholarship. You've got to be kidding me, okay? Go look at the numbers nationally of how many kids get scholarships. By the way, it's never, ever a full ride. You've got to be kidding. Maybe they'll help you with tuition. Are they paying for your food? Are they paying for your lodging? Are they paying for your movies and entertainment? There's nothing that's a full ride. You've got to be kidding me. But guess what? If you nail and do well in school, and then you take these ACTs, let's see if I can do this. Let's take an ACT, because the general West Coast kids generally take ACTs. And let's go to a college. Let's say Emory Riddle. And you make a 24, which, oh, by the way, is the minimum you have to apply for an ROTC scholarship. Okay? And I don't know the numbers. I'm going to get in trouble probably because I'm putting numbers up here. But if you're actually going to college and making a 24 the first time you took it, that is great. Congratulations. You qualify for a lot of scholarships. But if you make a 26 or a 28 or a 30, the amount of money you get is a merit scholarship, merit-based, how well you did, is huge. If you make a 30, you may get $30,000 versus a 25, you may get $8,000. So is it important to study for this test or have a job down at McDonald's because I'm going to earn $2,000? You've got to be kidding me, guys. Think about the big picture. As a teenager, studying your job and doing well in high school is the way to succeed. All right, as a senior, you have your plan. Let's say you don't want to go to college. You want to go to ITT down in Phoenix, learn to be a mechanic. You want to go to the chef school down in Phoenix. I got one of the national chef schools in America, best ones in America down in Phoenix. As a junior, you have a plan. As a junior, you're getting your ducks in order, getting ready to apply. But as a junior, you really need to start worrying about money, 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 money. How are you going to pay for stuff? And that's a whole nother lecture that I've told some of you guys, but maybe I'll do this in May. But basically, there's many different ways to pay for college. You want to do it as free as possible so you don't have to be in debt. And getting a loan is about the last thing you want to do. Okay? It depends. Maybe you want to get a loan versus going to mommy, daddy, bank, because that can be bad too. But we will see. But anyway, in junior year, you need to start worrying about scholarships and what you're applying for. In junior year, you need to come up with your plan. If you're going to college, maybe have 5 different options. If you want to go to ITT or do a professional career training, you need to go find those schools and visit with them. Senior year, you're applying. When do you start applying for college? Someone, Cadet McGee, when do you start applying for college?
Senior year.
When? Give me a date.
Beginning of senior year.
Thank you for playing. Next. When do you start applying for college? Cadet Varro.
No,
huh?
I don't know, sir.
At least he's honest. Uninformed, but honest. Could it be?
End of your junior year.
Close. What day?
Oh, I was going to say the end of your senior year.
Senior year? People are gone. Don't do that. You'll be too late. May 1st of your junior year. Everybody say, May 1st. And that's pretty much it. That's pretty much it nationally, because when is the last day to accept an invitation to go to college?
May
1st of your
senior year.
May 1st of your senior year is the time you accept, as soon as the day that they accept everybody for this year, guess what? That opens, dink, they push the button and you can start applying. So you can either be lazy between your junior and senior year, go to the beach, hang out, and then you come back senior year in that first semester when you're supposed to be going, having fun, going to football games and dating and taking the easy classes. You've got a pretty stressful first semester senior year because all the applications are over by 1 January. Maybe 1 February, some of them. But I mean, pretty much quick. So you can either work during the summer or you work during the school year, but to apply to ITT or application process, interviews, teacher recommendation, resumes, all these things have to happen for you to go to anything after high school. Colleges, at least two essays, at least, some of them three. And they're very specific. You have something like called a common application. So you can have one resume that goes to 5 different colleges. Guess what? The colleges are smart. They ask you specific, say, okay, well, let me have an addendum and give you another application, another essay you have to write for University of Arizona, University of Colorado, or Texas. And they'll be very specific. You can't copy-paste. They passed that point. So then in senior year, you have to go through the application. By Christmas of senior year, it's over. Done. Okay, you have applied to college, and you've gotten your money, and you have your plan. When do you get accepted to any of these things? When do you get accepted to after high school programs? Hello, if you finish applying by Christmas senior year, when do you get accepted? Oh, by the way, I just told you.
May 1st,
your senior year. Yeah, good job. Well, it depends. You can apply early. You can apply early, and sometimes you get accepted like by 1 December if you're absolutely fantastic in ITT or whatever, or college. But in general, by May 1st, your senior year, you know the game plan. Okay? You got accepted or else somebody else is going to take it. Okay? All right. I just wanted to bring this up because, again, I have seen this this week, and it did not make me happy that some of you guys did not know the plan that you'd be doing in college. All right. Change course. Page 130, please. Let's finish up lesson 1. Yes, sir.
Are we going to do announcements, sir?
Are we going to do announcements? Sure. We can do announcements. I don't think we have anything on announcements. Here is our announcements. And we talked about SLS yesterday. We have orienteering meeting was yesterday. This was wrong. Tomorrow is a big day. We have 2 color guards coming up. I will be, let's see, tomorrow afternoon I'll be here. Tomorrow morning I'll be gone doing the color guards. And then we have the uniform of the day today and community service this next weekend. Thank you. All right, page 130. We are on, going to finish up lesson 1. We talked about the Tuskegee Airmen. We talked about the fact that they were trained in Tuskegee, Alabama. And they were getting ready to go to war. And basically it created the Army Air Corps and increased the numbers. Who is a gentleman named Hap Arnold? Has anybody ever heard of him? Who is General Hap Arnold? What did he do? Did he play on the New York Giants last night and hit 3 home runs? I'm just kidding. It's World Series.
World Series was awesome. The Giants
destroyed. What did General Hap Arnold do there, Cadet Garrett? Turn 2, page 142 of your book. Let me see if I can get this up. Who was Hap Arnold?
Uh,
that's a pretty good answer. First five-star general in the United States Army Air Forces. First five-star general. That's pretty cool. Yes, sir.
Mind if I point two things out? One, he served in both World Wars, one and two. He was taught to fly from Orville Wright, the father of flight, and he graduated from West Point, which is an extremely esteemed military college.
That's pretty amazing. Think about being taught by Orville Wright how to fly and not dying. That is a pretty good deal, right? It was a pretty good deal. He was in the right place at the right time. He was very, very smart. And you know what? I am pretty certain that this gentleman was the first person to get an aeronautical engineering degree from Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT. He was a doctor. It's pretty incredible. So yeah, he was in the right place at the right time. He was the five-star general, the only air commander ever to receive that award. So yeah, he was a great guy. And he also had the dream of us being a separate armed forces. And he came up with the idea of training civilian pilots. They had individual volunteers from the civilian world training the military pilots because we needed to crank out so many pilots. You know, here's a safety question. During World War II, what was more dangerous, training or flying in combat?
Training.
That's a crazy thought, but yes, it was very, very dangerous to train, and we had many more people die in training accidents than actually shot down in combat. Isn't that crazy? Now it's the opposite. Training, we've got our act together with training, and it would work out. So look at it. 300,000 pilots earned their private pilot certificates. 300,000. Isn't that crazy? That's a lot of number. Oh, reminded me. Play a YouTube video. All right, Billy Mitchell. We talked about him. This is our final thing on Billy Mitchell. We want to see what he looks like. He was one that's court-martialed because of all this separation. Okay? Terrible thing. Let's see. I don't think there's any audio with this. Let's try it. But we can see all the how the people actually looked at the time. Pretty dashing guy, huh? Looks like an Army guy versus a military Air Force guy. Actually, there is no audio to this. Can you imagine a coat and tie flying all the time? You've got to be kidding me. This is him actually going into the court-martial.
Look at him, he's smiling. He's happy as can be.
Well, he certainly got a lot of attention. Remember, he predicted the attack on Pearl Harbor?
Now imagine if the day that happened, he was just smiling, going, I knew. Told you.
All right, then on the right. This is a very famous picture of the actual court-martial. And what was it, 1927? What was that? What is it back there? 21? People don't look all that happy. Look at their...
No, because he called them almost treasonous.
It was treason. And he was fired and basically chose to get out because insubordination is refusal to submit to authority. He was convicted, and that was 1926 videos here, 1926. And I guess that's his wife and a new job. If he's got, if he doesn't have a job anymore because he got fired. So that gives an idea of what happens to somebody when you're too much of a radical. Okay, we talked about the Tuskegee Airmen. You guys need to know where that came from and the fact that they did well. Ooh, we went and we haven't talked about the B-17, have we? Have we talked about the B-17? Oh my goodness, I have got a great B-17 thing for you here. Tell me about the B-17.
They were awesome.
They were awesome.
Angels on our shoulders.
Angels on our shoulders. How many engines did a B-17 have?
Two.
Four.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Zero.
Zero.
It's a glider.
Is it Liberty Bell? There was actually a... I'm sorry I didn't call this up here. There it is. This is kind of a fun clip that actually shows you B-17s and how many died. Imagine seeing that movie. B-17s was the workhorse of World War II for the Air Force, right?
Was faster than any.
Was the B-17 in the Air Force?
No,
it was Army Air Corps. Just a trick question. Okay. All right. Super. Yes, sir. Cadet Kramer.
Did most of those people die?
Yep. Dead.
Oh. Like, yeah.
Didn't it say 48,000 crew members were died?
Oh, I didn't see that.
As many died in B-17s in all of Vietnam. I think there was like 55,000 actually in Vietnam and 48 and these things.
Close enough.
Yeah, so pretty much. It was amazing. Yes, ma'am.
Were you ever going to answer the question that you just asked?
What did I ask?
How many engines does it have?
How many engines does it
have? Four.
Great job. There you go. Great job. Four. That was kind of an innovation. That was exactly right. That was good.
Creating a flying brick.
Exactly. And the idea was, of course, these planes were being shot down, and we had to design a pursuit plane, a P plane, to protect the bombers. And with that, we were able to protect them and do enormous harm on the enemy during
Axis.
World War II. Yes, sir?
The Axis
for the bad guys. Yeah, exactly. All righty. Actually, once the B-17 was built, long-range bombing missions came into reality and realized we could be completely separate from the Army because we had a separate capability. And the fact that it could be an offensive weapon. It wasn't just defending the guys on the ground. We could take it deep and long and drop bombs and wipe pee things out. The Army did not want us, to be independent. They thought of us as artillery. Isn't that crazy? They wanted to keep Army because that kept us with Army. They would keep them more money and have individual forces. All righty. That concludes our lesson one. Lesson two is Monday, Air Power in World War II. So you guys can look at that, please. Cadet McGee, why don't we get going here, and we will dismiss the class.
Flight, Hudson, Hutt. Dismiss.
Go to great days.